Good evening. I'd like to call to order the Planning Commission meeting of April 13th, 2009. I'd like to ask Commissioner Al Adams if he would lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Will the clerk please call the roll?
Commissioner Adam?
Here.
Commissioner Fisher?
Here.
Commissioner Grumney?
Here.
Commissioner Reynolds?
Here.
Chair Lund? Absent.
Tonight we have a new city staff member joining us on the dais, and Mr. Mark Towne will be introducing him.
Thank you, Madam Chair. It's my distinct pleasure to introduce our new Assistant City Attorney, Mr. Chris Norman, to my left. Mr. Norman started his position with the city today and is here tonight with us to give you some idea about how he is hitting the ground running. Mr. Norman comes to us from the city of San Buenaventura, where he served as Chief Assistant City Attorney for the past 7 years. Prior to that, he served for several years at the city of Santa Ana as their chief land use advisor, and prior to that in a private firm in Orange, California, where he was the managing attorney. Chris received his undergraduate degree at Occidental College, which is near to Eagle Rock, which is where I grew up, and after that went off to University of Chicago Law School. And so we are very pleased that Mr. Norman has joined the Thousand Oaks team and look forward to many years working together collaboratively.
Mark, thanks for that introduction. It was very kind. I'm really looking forward to working with the commission and the departments, especially community development. So you know, I am married and I have two boys that are 8 and 7. I do live in Ventura, and I'm really looking forward to hopefully adding some value to the city. So thanks for those kind words.
On behalf of all of the planning commissioners, I'd like to welcome you, Chris, and I'll let you know that we really are looking forward to working with you. Now is the time for public comment. At this time, any person may address the commission regarding a city planning matter that is not on this evening's agenda. Should the commission wish to discuss an issue raised by a member of the public, the issue will be referred to staff for scheduling on a future agenda. Anyone who'd like to speak under the public comment must complete a white speaker card and file it with the recording secretary before the public comments portion of the agenda is called. The speaker's remarks should be addressed to the commission as a whole and not to an individual commissioner or staff member. Speakers are limited to 5 minutes, and the light on the timer would go off to yellow when you have 1 minute remaining. There are no cards that have been submitted this evening for public comments. We are now to written comments, announcements, and continuances. Mr. Towne.
Thank you, Madam Chair. We do have one announcement in terms of a supplemental packet, which was distributed this afternoon. This contains a copy of the deed restriction that the City Council required be recorded on the property in 1991. This deed restriction was referred to in the staff report at the bottom of page 7 of your packet, page 5 of the Commission's staff report. So this enables the Commission to see the original document, and so that is the entirety of that supplemental packet. Thank you.
We will now open the public hearing. Will the clerk please open case 6A?
Hearing advertised as required by law is hereby open to consider agenda item 6A regarding TTM 2008-70436 and SUP 2008-70435. Applicant, Hilltop Builders, LLC, request to consider a mitigated negative declaration and mitigation monitoring plan. Allow division of a 54.3-acre parcel into two lots, with one lot of 48.7 acres to be permanent natural open space and another lot of 5.6 acres for commercial office condominium purposes and allow construction of a two-story commercial office building and mezzanine over a combination above-below parking structure. Location, western terminus of Grande Vista Drive.
Can you call the applicant? Oh, I'm going to call the applicant. Oh. Now I'd like to call staff for their presentation.
Thank you, Chair Garbney and members of the commission. Good evening. The applicant is Hilltop Builders, LLC. The case is SUP 2008-70435 and tend of track map 2008-70836. The PowerPoint presentation I'd like to go forward with. The location of the project is at the western terminus of Grande Vista Drive, the north side of the 101 freeway. The proposal is to construct a two-story commercial office condominium building with mezzanine over a combination above-below parking structure. The applicant's request for the tentative track map is to allow the division of 54.3-acre parcel into two lots, one lot of 5.6 acres for commercial office condominium purposes, another 48.7-acre lot to be dedicated in fee title as permanent natural open space to the Kaneo Open Space Conservation Agency. The special use permit is to allow construction of a two-story commercial office condominium building with the mezzanine over a combination above-below parking structure. There are two requests, deviations essentially, to allow a manufactured slope angle of 2-to-1 in lieu of a 3-to-1 for slope adjacent to the 101 freeway, and to allow encroachment into natural terrain greater than 25% grade. This is an aerial of the project location. You can see the 54-acre parcel in red, and the portion that is to be developed is outlined in yellow. The 101 freeway is to the south. To the north is Seventh-day Adventist open space. To the east, you'll see the USPS annex. And to the south of the freeway is the Kaneo open space and an adjacent industrial park. The truck scales are at the terminus, or at least close to the terminus of this particular parcel on the far west end. This is a view of the property from Grande Vista Drive. On September 24, 1991, the City Council adopted the zone change from RE 1-acre, residential exclusive, 1-acre minimum lot size, to M1, industrial park, and OS open space. On September 7, 1993 and May 19, 1998, the City Council approved amendments to the General Plan Land Use Amendment from undevelopable to industrial and existing parks, golf courses, and open space for the 54-acre property. The property consists of 54.3 acres of land. 90% of the property, 48.7 acres, will remain as open space. Development area is confined to 5.6 acres, including a 100-foot brush clearance area. And the graded area for the building and parking lot comprised 2.9 acres. The building consists of two-story with a mezzanine to take advantage of the views and allow more natural light to the interior of the building. It's a V-shaped building, and it provides articulation and is consistent with the freeway corridor design guidelines. Parking areas consist of combination above, below ground, parking structure, and surface spaces. And also city gateway sign will be constructed by the applicant. The project is also including green building measures. Into the design, the solar photovoltaic panels will be provided on a flat roof areas. The building is designed over a combination of above, below parking structure to minimize the heat island effect. And use of water-efficient fixtures will be incorporated into the building, as well as windows will consist of insulated low E-glazing. And there will be a use of recycled construction materials. This is a view of the site plan. You can see the gateway sign closest to the terminus of Grande Vista Drive. and access through the city parcel, which is extension of Grande Vista Drive, to the actual building. It's a front elevation of the building. This will be the side that's adjacent to the 101 freeway, will be viewed from the freeway. These are east wing elevations, partial east elevation, partial south elevation, and partial west elevation. West wing elevations of the building, we have a partial north elevation, partial west elevation, and partial south elevation. The south elevation shows the two areas of the above ground and below ground parking structure entrance and exits. This is a rendering from the northbound lanes going west on the 101 freeway without the landscaping. And we have a view shed rendering from the westbound or northbound lanes going west from the 101 freeway with the landscaping. We also have a rendering from the eastbound or southbound lanes actually going east of the 101 freeway without landscaping. This is a sections key showing various sections through the property, through the project. And we have section A, section B, section C, and section D showing the various areas of cut and fill. Most of the cut will be for the underground parking garage structure. Environmental review, the mitigated negative declaration number 272 and mitigation monitoring program was prepared in compliance with CEQA section 15070. All potentially significant adverse effects have been mitigated to an insignificant level in the form of suggested conditions and/or design revisions to the submitted plans, and the applicant has agreed to the mitigation measures. Encroachment into the natural terrain of 25% or greater slopes. The area of encroachment is less than 1 acre. It's 0.94 acres. Most of the encroachment is in low-lying areas not readily visible. We have a detailed slope map that shows encroachment needed to allow reasonable and conforming use of the property. And the larger hillside areas and ridge lines are preserved as open space. This particular view shows the 25% encroachments. Also requested is a modification of the slope angle. This is a manufactured slope angle of 3:1 is the grading standard for this in accordance with Resolution 79-270. The south-facing slope adjacent to the 101 freeway is requested to go from 3:1 to 2:1. And this will reduce the 25% encroachment. There are minimal differences in visual impacts between the 3:1 and 2:1 slope angles. Staff's recommendation is to approve the final mitigated negative declaration number 272 and mitigation monitoring program, the tentative tract map 2008-70436 and special use permit 2008-70435. Subject to the findings and conditions detailed in the staff report. We also have various staff members available for any questions. We have Mr. Greg Smith for environmental questions, Beth Baden for traffic. Wes is also here for engineering and police, Ann Koska, and our landscape architect, John Ennis. Thank you.
Are there any questions of city staff? Commissioner Adams.
Thank you very much. Hi, Ms. Lupo.
Hello.
How are we doing? Okay, just a couple of things. That debris basin that they're going to build behind the building.
Yes.
Is that going to be visible from the freeway?
It will not.
It will not be visible.
No, the building will essentially hide all of the grading.
Okay.
In that, with regard to that particular debris basin.
Will there be any adverse effects on the hillside from that debris basin? It's relatively big, I think. It's like 150 cubic yards, so.
It's sort of a natural area to create a debris basin, and I can have Mr. Greg Smith address it a little bit further if you wish from an environmental point of view.
Sure.
The grading for the debris.
The grading for the debris basin is accommodated within the footprint of the graded pad area. It's in an area that is naturally occurring within a naturally occurring drainage basin. It's the natural spot to locate a facility like this, and there are no significant plant or animal habitats in that area that would be impacted. So, no, it's not expected to have a significant effect. Okay, good. Quick question for Ms. Baden, if I may.
Members of the Commission, Commissioner Adams, my name is Larry Tay. I'm with the Traffic Engineering Division.
Hi, Larry. Thanks. This just has to do with the traffic. Of course, that Wendy intersection is are D-rated right now, and we're going to run about 800 more car trips, average daily trips, because of this project. And what I would like to know is, and the applicant's going to spend, you know, about almost $90,000 on traffic mitigation fees. Are we still timeline-wise okay for the widening of that? Are we still looking at 2012? Have there been any changes or?
No, the City of Thousand Oaks has a capital improvement project, CI 5050, underway to improve the Wendy Drive interchange, which is under Caltrans jurisdiction. Caltrans project approval and approval of the project's environmental documents are anticipated in May 2009, with design beginning, you know, shortly after, and construction completed in 2012. So that's still the timeline.
Good. Okay. I mean, because we are, you know, putting in projects, that's imperative that we get that bridge done. But sounds like we're in good shape there. Okay, great. And just one other quick question. Of course, this is a scenic highway, you know, the 101, and it calls for the landscaping to exist between the freeway and the building. In fact, they refer to it as a corridor of landscaping. Do you think we're going to get that effect? I mean, it looks like it to me from the plans, but.
Sorry, can you repeat that?
Because it's a scenic highway, there's supposed to be, quote unquote, a corridor of landscaping between the building and the freeway. And from the plans, it looks like we're going to get that. Do you feel we're going to get that?
Yes, we will. If you go out there today and look at the landscaping that's in place with the adjacent commercial offices, you're going to get a very similar screening effect. A lot of those buildings are well landscaped. This plan actually has a slope that is fairly comprehensively landscaped. As you can see in the MND, we provided exhibits that show the post-landscaping phase, and it's very effective in terms of the kind of landscape materials that are being presented and proposed on this project.
In fact, it
almost disappears from view, and that's why we do these without landscaping.
Yeah, it looked like that to me too. In fact, it looks like we're requiring some bigger trees than we may have normally done.
If I can, Commissioner Adams, there is a condition number 133, and it's requiring additional landscaping. So okay. We have more than what we normally require.
Okay, good. Thank you very much.
Commissioner Reynolds.
Thank you. Good evening, Mr. Leopold. Driving up Grande Vista Drive, I noticed the street is really in bad shape. Will this project have to do anything? And it's more down close to the area where Costco was going to be. Is there any requirement to fix the street at all? I'm talking about the paving of it. I know it's narrower there until you get the end of that property, but...
I'd like traffic to respond, but initially, when you're driving a lot of trucks over that particular area, there will be some repair of that street eventually.
Okay, that's what I thought, that the trucks are going to beat it up even more so.
The developer will be responsible for a number of street and frontage improvements. There will be street widening from, I guess, the terminus of Grande Vista mm-hmm. all the way down to the existing post office. There will be a curb, gutter, and sidewalk on the north side of this, or sidewalk to the north side of the street as well. I think the total length of the improvement runs about 1,000 feet.
Okay. I'm talking about closer down to Windy Drive, but I noticed that's where it was really in the most disarray. But this project won't be conditioned at all to fix any of that then.
I don't believe so.
And just another question of general information. They are putting in a city gateway sign. This is on the westbound of the west area, the city. Where is the other sign at the east end of our city?
That's a good question.
There's one
I don't
that
have
says,
an answer to that.
There's one that says Westlake Village that's up on the hill. But I always wonder, well, where is the other sign? If they're putting in the one at the west, did somebody have to put one in at the east?
If I can answer that question, I believe as you're traveling westbound, it's over near the GTE building. It's near the freeway. It's visible. And it's a gateway sign.
Okay, because there's one that does say yes. Westlake Village. That's always there.
Yes, but there's the City of Thousand Oaks gateway sign as well.
Oh. Okay, thank you.
If I could expand on that, the easterly sign is not constructed yet. It was proposed to be on the Baxter property. That was the east sign. This is the west sign, and then there was one adjacent to the 23 freeway also. Those were all planned. The drawings were developed, but the monies were not there to build those three signs at the time. So now we have this property under. If this property gets approved, then we will get the westerly one constructed.
And the others then will eventually be done, is that it? But meanwhile, we'll have a west sign.
That's the hope. I know there was some discussion last year on the easterly one, but I'm not sure how far that got.
Okay, thank you. Then it wasn't something that I missed for 37 years looking for this. Okay,
no.
Thank you.
Okay, now we will have speakers for the case. The first will be the applicant, who will have 15 minutes. Other speakers on this case will have 5 minutes, and at the end of all speakers, the applicant will have 5 minutes for any rebuttal. Our main speaker is Frank Marosco. I hope I pronounced your name correctly, with Hilltop Builders.
And members of the commission, Pam Leopold, and all the assembled staff members who came out tonight. My name is Frank Marosco. I'm the manager of Hilltop Builders, the developer of the project. My address is 4000 Calle Tecate Avenue in Camarillo. After my introduction, I want to cede a portion of my time to the project's architects, Nils Johnson and John Worthy, for a further, more detailed presentation. In addition to the architects, we also have in attendance, to answer questions that you might have, our civil engineer, Randy Toter, our landscape architect, Lynn Johnson, our legal counsel, Mr. Bill Kohler, and our project coordinator, Steve Dallier. I'd like to begin by saying that we agree with the conditions which attach to the project. In general sense, this project we feel is consistent with the Thousand Oaks general plan, and it also conforms with a long-standing tradition of mandating and using open space. With our project being 54 acres, we're only allocating about 5.4 acres, I think, to development. The other 90% of the project is going to remain in open space. We feel like we have minimized the visibility by both landscaping and through setbacks. The visibility, too, has been reduced by putting 90% of the parking underground. We also have 180 spaces, and the city requirement, I think, is 173. About 3 years ago, we contracted with the Sullivan family to purchase their 54-acre parcel. And upon examining the site, our vision was to create a particularly attractive building, something that said, oh, wow, as you drove by. I asked the architects also to incorporate Ventura County's green building recommendations. They were able to do that. We also asked Lynn Johnson, our landscape architect, to create a landscape plan with mature trees. This was so that the building would look complete from the very beginning. From the inside of the building, those who are using the building, they're going to be provided with 14-foot-high windows And from the site, I don't know if you visited or if you could see it, you'll look out on the entire Conejo Valley, and you'll look out on the Santa Monica Mountains. It will really be an impressive place to be and to work. Finally, before I invite our architects up, I wanted to comment on the planning process. I wasn't used to it so much, and when we first came in and were assigned to Pam, we thought we had the most perfect project. She soon convinced us that that wasn't quite the case. We worked and created, and we went back and forth. And at first, I resented the whole process, so I came to believe that with her encouragement, the project, like a letter that you write over and over again, it gets better and better. The same thing occurred. So with the project. So in coming to you tonight, with all the changes and all the time that we've taken, we hope that the project can win your approval. And at this point, I'd like to invite up John and Niels. And then we'll answer questions right after their presentation, if you have some.
Chair Grumney, members of the commission, I'm John Worthy. I'm with Johnson & Muller Architects. I'm an architect representing the firm. We're at 1451 Rice Avenue in Oxnard. And I'll be discussing the building design and the green building measures that Frank alluded to. The following design concepts are based on the city design guidelines, as well as dealing with the challenges of the site topography. I do have, I've made copies, larger exhibits of the PowerPoint renderings. If that could be made available to the commissioners, I would appreciate that. The first thing, as I mentioned, with the challenge was the site planning with the site. The site's design and the building footprint were to reflect an integration of the building and the site. So the first thing, the project, the main building and the subterranean parking structure are located in a valley between two knolls in the site, therefore minimizing the visual impact of the mountain peaks and the ridge lines from the freeway. Secondly, because of the site, the building's footprint is a V formation, which allows the two building wings to parallel the natural slopes of the existing hillside to join the building and the site. Thirdly, the building wings also, as that V shape, increases the perceived open space between the freeway and the building. Also, it allows for a nice, welcoming entry plaza, and also allows, as Frank mentioned earlier, the views from the occupants with those wings maximize the views to the valley and to the surrounding mountains, both on the south side and the north side. The architectural design of the building was also, the scheme of that was also to integrate the building and the site. So the building materials and colors, we've got earthen color, stucco, we have stone, heavy use of stone, a copper penny roof, all reflect the natural colors and materials of the surroundings. The building itself, as you can see, the second floor steps back. That also helps to anchor the building in the site. Looks like it was always there. Also, the stone also helps to anchor it into the rugged site. The building's horizontal structure, the horizontal look of the building is also emphasized through colonnades, through deep overhangs, shadows. That's going to give you also a perceived lower building mass that's going to reduce the height of the building, the perception of that. Also, it's going to maintain the views above and beyond of the beautiful surroundings. The next thing I'd like to talk about that Frank alluded to was the green building measures that we're using on the project. These are building measures that are created by the Ventura County Regional Energy Alliance. and their recommended design concepts to maximize the occupants' enjoyment of the building and also to minimize the impacts of the surrounding community and environment. And there's basically five categories. There's site, there's energy, materials, water, and indoor environment. And I'm going to go quickly over those measures that we incorporated into our project. Site practices to control stormwater runoff and polluted runoff. We designed silt fencing and debris basins during construction, during site preparation to reduce pollution to get into the storm sewers. Also, the exterior parking area, the lighting will be shielded to prevent illumination and site illumination from polluting the night sky, so we'll have shielded illumination. And what we're really proud about is the parking structure is going to have plug-in parking. So it's going to have parking for electric used cars. So that's going to also encourage people to use transportation that's energy responsible. Some of the energy practices that we have that we've incorporated into the design, deep overhangs. We're going to have insulated glazing, low E glazing, also wall and roof insulation, which will reduce heat gain and reduce the need for air conditioning. Also from mechanical HVAC use, we're going to have some high energy, high efficient roof package units with refrigerants that captures and release heat better, so that equals less refrigerant. And also we're going to have tankless water heaters for on-demand water use. We're real proud of the roof-mounted solar photovoltaics, 254 in all that we've designed on the roof. That will provide up to two-thirds of the electrical lighting that's required. Water-wise, the landscape architect, Lynn Johnson, has incorporated native and/or drought-tolerant landscaping. Also have rain sensors on the irrigation controls to reduce water use. And finally, the last category, indoor air quality, is we're going to use building materials and finishes that are low VOC, that minimize off-gassing, toxic off-gassing over time. We're also going to locate outside air ventilation intakes away from the freeway, which could be a potential or is a pollution source. We're going to locate those on the north side of the building to improve the air quality. And also
Mr.
we're going
to... Mr. Worthy, we need to have you wrap
up. Okay. And the last thing, provide occupants with individual control over lighting, heating, and cooling. Thank you for your time.
Are there any questions of Mr. Marasco or Mr. Worthy from the planning? Commissioner Adam?
Hi. That's quite an impressive list of green building measures. Are you going to apply for LEED certification?
Can you come back up to the podium? Was your question, Commissioner Adam, was Mr. Worthy?
Yes, it was.
Okay.
Thank you.
Your question to whether it's going to be certified through the LEED program. At this time, the direction is to go with the Ventura County green measures. The idea of that is to keep the focus, the time, and money into the building, to the copper roof, to the stone, to the challenges of the site. Thank you.
Well, you might consider that at some time, because ultimately it'd make the building more valuable. Thanks.
Okay, the next speaker card I have is from Mr. Bill Kohler. Okay, that's for questions only. I also have for questions only a speaker card from Stephen Dullier. Okay, Lynn Johnson. Nils Johnson. Okay, and Randy, I'm going to say this. Toadter? Oh, did you do okay? Oh, thank you. Does the commission have any questions for any of these? Okay. If not, we will go back to staff for any questions or comments.
Staff has no further comments at this time.
Is there any questions from the commissioners for staff? Okay. Then we will go back to our applicant.
Mr. Marasco, do you have any further statement that you'd like to make at this time? Can you take the dais?
Thank you for the opportunity, but no, not at this time.
Okay. Then we will go back to the commission, and we will close the public hearing, and we will move towards commission discussions and or a motion. Commissioner Reynolds.
Thank you. Very interesting presentation. There are several things of the project that I really like, and that's the additional landscaping between the freeway and the building. And of course, I'm always one that's looking for the handicap parking, and this project exceeds the requirements of the handicap, and also it's 7 parking spaces over what's required for the site. I think it's great that our city will eventually get a West Gateway sign. We'll gain 48 plus acres of open space. There's all kinds of green building measures, and I was really pleased to hear that. I know a LEED certification takes an awful lot and a lot of money, so at least working with the green building measures. And also the end of this cul-de-sac will be removed during the times of the beginning of the war, and my son's a Marine. There were some really nasty signs that somebody placed at the end of that cul-de-sac, and I used to drive by shaking my fist mad at that. So I will be glad to see the end of the cul-de-sac there. And with that, I would like to move approval of TTM 2008-70436 and the SUP 2008-70435 and the mitigated negative declaration number 272 approval.
Comments?
With the conditions and findings as in the packet.
Comments on the motion, Commissioner Fisher?
Yes, I will support Commissioner Reynolds' recommendation for what she brought forward. I think the building looks great, especially with the buffer of that additional landscaping between the building and the freeway, and more importantly, gaining 48 acres of open space. That's a big chunk to add to the city's growing open space, so proud to support it.
Commissioner Adam.
Thank you. Yeah, it's a great building, very innovative design. Almost seems a shame to cover it up with the landscaping, but no, not quite though. Commissioner Reynolds is quite right. I do appreciate extra landscaping too, but it's a great design, and it fits right into the hill, like you said, that V shape fits right in there. I'm just so glad that Thousand Oaks has a scenic highway element, and we're enforcing it. And you people have really taken some care in this design. I can see it. Ms. Leopold has stepped in, and my compliments to her as well, and came up with a really nice building, I think. You know, you drive down the 101 freeway, and you head past Thousand Oaks, and you start going east, and you start seeing what's along that freeway, and you just say to yourself, man, I'll tell you, glad I'm at Thousand Oaks. I mean, that freeway has become canyonized, and we don't have that here. And you folks have added to the what we need along our freeway. So obviously, I'm going to support the motion, and I appreciate the green building that you did as well. So good building. Thanks.
Commissioner Reynolds, any final comments? If not, could we all vote?
Motion passed 4-0.
There is a 10-day appeal period. For any aggrieved party who wishes to appeal the Planning Commission's decision may do so by filing an appeal with the Community Development Department within 10 days. We're going to move on to Community Development Department reports and referrals.
Thank you, Madam Chair. In terms of upcoming cases, those are outlined on page 78 of your packet. We have several cases planned for April 27th, your next meeting, as well as May 11th. We have the Many Mansions project. And then June 8th, already looking forward to Parkside B out at Dos Vientos Ranch. as well as a zone change item in addition to that. In terms of cases that have been heard by the Planning Commission and have been heard or will be heard by the City Council, there was the Home Depot case, which the Planning Commission had approved on January 26th and was appealed to the City Council. City Council approved the appeal, and thereby denying the project on March 31st. Also, the Belmont Village case, which the Commission approved on March 9th, I wanted to mention has been appealed to the City Council, but specifically with regard to the non-residential linkage fee requirement. So that case has not yet been scheduled for a City Council hearing. And then finally, the case which you heard on March 23rd at your most recent meeting will be heard by the City Council on May 19th. That was the redesign case that was referred back to the Planning Commission for which you recommended approval to the City Council. And those are all the comments that I have at this time. Thank you.
Can I have someone to do the approval of the minutes? Commissioner Reynolds.
Move approval of the minutes of the March 23rd, 2009 meeting.
Vote. Any AB...
Motion passed, 4-0.
Any AB 1234 reports? Commissioner Reynolds.
Thank you. I had the pleasure of attending the League of Cities Planning Institute down in Anaheim, and once again enjoyed all the different workshops that I went to. There were very few of us there this time, but from the city, but it is always interesting to see old friends and to hear new things. Thank you.
Now is the time for any commission comments. Are there any comments from my fellow commissioners? Commissioner Reynolds.
I'm sorry. Yes, before our next meeting, in fact, the weekend before, the Thousand Oaks Rotary Club will be putting on the annual chili cook-off at the Canale Creek Park, and this time it's a two-day event with Saturday evening from 4 to 10. There'll be a Beatlemania concert and food and a kids' area, and then on Sunday will be our annual chili cook-off with lots of good drinks, beer and wine, and there will be a car show this year. So I hope that the community comes forward, even though there'll be a mini Canale Valley Days this year after this event. I hope they come out for the chili cook-off.
Thank you. Okay, without any further comments, the meeting is adjourned for April 27th, 2009.